talking about sort of the peripheral question of what we will end up having to deal with directly by way of brick and mortar. And a lot of folks have come in to talk about placement of mental health patients. We are having the conversation to let anybody talk to us that would like to talk to us. The first thing we're going to do is go around the table, at least the committee members, and introduce themselves. And anybody who is subsequently coming up to testify, if you could have the seat where Sarah Squirrel is currently at, and then announce your name and what your position may be. And just to remind you all, we are being recorded. So even if you don't like the decisions at the impeachment trial down in Washington, D.C., we kind of try to keep the record as clean as we possibly can. So, Cheryl,
would
you like to...
I'm not going to talk impeachment, really.
Yeah, we'll find a
little Cheryl Hooker Rowland.
Dick Mazza, Grand Isle.
And I'm Joe Betting from Caledonia County. I'm the chair of this particular institution's committee. Sarah, we invited you in to begin the conversation, and please take it away.
Yes. Well, good afternoon. For the record, Sarah Squirrel, Commissioner of the Department of Mental Health.
And Morning Fox, Deputy Commissioner, Department of Mental Health.
So yes, the committee requested an overview of beds, kind of the status of beds in the state of Vermont. We actually just submitted a report that is a comprehensive overview and analysis of bed needs across the state. The committee didn't necessarily ask us to do a full walkthrough of that report. However, we did provide it to you so that you could take a look at it. And what we'll be testifying today is a summary of residential bed capacity across the state of Vermont, as well as inpatient capacity, just to give you a sense of what it all looks like and how it fits together, especially as we look to kind of advance the appropriate facilities to support the overall system of care. Of course, given that it's Mental Health Advocacy Day, this is a nice opportunity for us to underscore the significance of need and the urgency to ensure that when Vermonters need the right care at the right time, it's absolutely essential. So the legislative charge that we had for this report was really to look at an analysis of bed needs, looking at rural locations across the state of Vermont, historic occupancy rates, an analysis of access, barriers to access, barriers to discharge. Also, it asked us to work with individuals who are either currently receiving services at some of these settings or maybe previously had in these settings.
Sarah, if I can interrupt.
Yes.
Are these the reports we're referring to?
Yeah, so you have the PowerPoint is what we're going to be walking through.
Okay.
That is the full report. We aren't going through all of the content in that report because that would be another hour of testimony. We're trying to give you the high-level view of the system of care so that you walk away having a good sense of where beds are and where needed capacity is. So this is kind of a hybrid of looking at residential beds as well as inpatient beds. So if you keep flipping through, going to adult residential settings, we're going to kind of walk through within our residential system of care what our current capacity is in Vermont, how we define that level of care, and how people access it. So the first level of care that we're going to focus on is group homes. We have 19 group homes across the state of Vermont for a total of 151 beds. One thing that's important to consider with group homes that they are more in line with long-term care. So when we think about our intensive recovery residentials, our recovery residences, or other residential step-down capacity, they're designed to be more transitional. Group homes are actually for individuals who need extended care and possibly long-term care and will be living there for long periods of time. They're licensed facilities. They are available to individuals who are enrolled in our community rehabilitation treatment and support program. So they're connected to the Department of Mental Health in a designated agency because they're enrolled in the CRT program. Individuals who are served in group homes do require more intensive treatment. So if they could be served in a less restrictive community-based setting, we would certainly like to see that. For some individuals, they need access just 24/7 ongoing care. Group homes also include skill-based training, daily living skills, access to a kitchen, living areas, treatment supports, medication management, and supported counseling. Some individuals are on an order of non-hospitalization and under the care and custody of the Commissioner of Mental Health. So moving on, the next, I guess, tier in terms of our residential system of care in the state of Vermont are what we refer to as intensive recovery residences, otherwise known as IRRs. We have six of these residences across the state for a total of 47 beds. This level of care also includes our peer-run program, which is the Soteria House, which is offered through Pathways. Essentially, this is frequently utilized for step-down from hospital level of care. So typically, individuals who are in our inpatient setting who are not able to transition directly back to the community, the intensive recovery residents provide step-down care for those individuals, and they have an anticipated length of stay between 6 and 18 months. One thing that's important to remember about intensive recovery residentials versus group homes tend to be accessed from the community level, meaning that your local designated agency is likely making the referral to the group home for you, and they're a more localized resource. Intensive recovery residentials were actually designed to be a statewide resource for those primarily who are under the care and custody of the Commissioner of Mental Health. So when we think of IRRs in terms of geography across the state, we take geography into consideration, but they're accessed by anyone in the state at any given time who simply needs an intensive recovery residence, whereas group homes tend to be accessed through your local community mental health agency.
So you took, can
I? Yes.
Okay. The peer-run program, you said, is run by Pathways?
Yes.
So is that just then only offered in those counties where Pathways is established?
It's one specific location. So it's one actual intensive recovery residence that is run by Pathways that is peer-run. And that's a level of programming that some individuals really flourish in and are referred to and has been very successful. Act 79 actually required us to put into place what would be considered a hospital diversion program that is peer-run, and Soteria is our peer-run diversion program, if you will.
Okay, where is that located?
It's in Burlington.
Burlington.
And it's the only brick-and-mortar home, if you will, that Pathways runs. Everything else that Pathways does throughout the state is with individuals in their individual apartments.
Okay.
And so this is the only program, if you will, that Pathways runs.
Intensive recovery residences have a pretty robust array of clinical staff that are on site. I know Second Spring, which is one of our intensive recovery residences, and leadership from Second Spring is here today, but they also have skilled nursing staff on site. They're working on transition skills, daily living skills, et cetera, medication management. Of course, the goal is to transition individuals to least restrictive lower levels of care as quickly as possible. I'll just keep on moving until somebody stops me. one thing to keep in mind also in terms of how we think of the management of the system of care, and flow is something we talk a lot about, how do we ensure that we're moving people in a timely way through different points of care as appropriate. Our Department of Mental Health Care Management Team, which is small but mighty, facilitates the management of these individuals and is kind of managing the referrals based on clinical readiness to access the intensive recovery residences. So just so that you're aware that DMH has a significant role in managing the step down of individuals from inpatient to access this level of care, and also, of course, looking at discharge as well, so that we can ensure that we're transitioning folks, that new individuals can access those beds.
So how small and mighty is this group?
Our care management team, we have a care management director, and we currently have three care managers. We're in the process of trying to fill that fourth position, but for many years it's been a four-person staff with a manager.
And working very closely in collaboration with our IRR partners. The next residential tier of facility and support that we have is the physically secure recovery residence, which this committee is well aware of. The Middlesex Therapeutic Community Residence was designed to be a temporary facility post-Hurricane Irene, built using FEMA funds, temporarily sited in Middlesex to serve as a step down. The intent was to ensure that from our highest level of care, which is our level one beds across the state, which at that time we decentralized. So Vermont State Hospital closed. We have 25 beds at BPCH, 14 beds at the Brattleboro Retreat, and then 6 level one beds at Rutland Regional Medical Center, representing individuals with the highest acuity of need. It's essential that we have a secure residential where they can step down to, given their heightened acuity and safety needs. 98%, 95% of individuals step down into the Middlesex Therapy Community Residence from a level one bed. In order to be placed at MTCR, the individual does need to be in the care and custody of the Commissioner of Mental Health. And I'll let Deputy Commissioner Maureen Fox speak to this, but there's a special court order by a judge that also needs to happen in order to access this level of care.
It's really quite common that an individual who's going from a hospital to an intensive residential, that they may be discharging from the hospital in order of non-hospitalization, which has them remaining under the care and custody of the commissioner, but in the community. However, in order to go to the Middlesex facility, it's not a may, it's a has to be. That's in statute, that person going there has to be under the care and custody of the commissioner. And not only in that circumstance, but the order of non-hospitalization has to speak to the fact that the individual needs that heightened level of security. So that, you know, we're not looking to have someone in a locked facility other than those who really need that type of facility. And so part of the legislation, you know, kind of envisioned that in court, a judge would have to weigh in on that piece of that need for that level of security. So they have to be discharged from a hospital on an order of non-hospitalization that speaks specifically to their need for that level of security.
And folks on this committee table are well aware that we are on our way to the expansion of our physically secure residential, expanding the capacity to a 16-bed physically secure residential facility with the capacity to perform emergency and voluntary procedures if indicated. This is an essential and top priority of the Agency of Human Services, as well as the administration. It is essential to expanding our overall continuum of care. And of course, the facility at the current Middlesex was designed to be temporary. So it is critical that we have this level of care, especially as we look to expand our level one capacity in the state of Vermont, which is also urgently needed. We'll be talking a little bit about level one. Our level one beds run at about 99% occupancy all the time. So when people ask me the question, do we still need these 12 new level one beds at the Brattleboro Retreat? Absolutely, yes we do. We also need to ensure that we have appropriate step down capacity. At any given time, this analysis is articulated later in the report. We have 10 to 15 individuals who are currently in our inpatient system of care that if we had a physically secure residence with the ability to perform emergency and voluntary procedures, we could transition them into this programming. Currently, those individuals remain stuck, if you will, because our 7-bed capacity is just not adequate, which of course backs up the whole system, and we end up with individuals waiting in the emergency departments because all of that essential level one capacity is full. So just to give you a sense of how this all kind of links together in terms of our continuum of care. Anything you would add to that? The next slide, this is just more of an overview of who our designated providers are. Many of the levels of care that I just indicated are managed through community partnerships with our designated agencies, our designated hospitals, our specialized service agencies, and some are state-owned, such as the State Secure Residential. Programs like Second Spring, that's actually a collaboration between Washington County Mental Health, Clara Martin Center, and the Howard Center. Is that correct, Scott?
Yes, it is.
The next slide shows provider capacity. So this is just intended to give you a sense of how many beds in each of these areas. You can see within our designated agencies, we have adult crisis bed capacity. We're not necessarily diving into that level of care, but just so that you're aware, we do have adult crisis bed capacity in the state at the designated agencies, youth crisis beds, and the adult intensive residential beds that we were just talking about, those IRRs. our peer service agencies, we do have a two-bed peer-run crisis center that's run through ALISM, as well as the Soteria program that we mentioned before. We have our physically secure residential that the state runs with 7 beds. And then on the right column, these are all of the designated hospitals and the inpatient capacity that they have. So that level one capacity, as I mentioned, is distributed between BPCH, the Retreat, and Rutland. We have non-level one capacity, which is our greater inpatient capacity across the state. We have an additional 156 beds and additional inpatient capacity. CVMC having 14 of those beds. Rutland Regional Medical Center has 17. UVMMC has 28. The Wyndham Center has 10 beds. I will just note that the Wyndham Center opted not to pursue designation status to the Department of Mental Health this year. They can still accept voluntary patients that can still continue to receive care there, but involuntary patients can no longer be admitted to Wyndham Center. And my sense is that is a direct result of some of the strategic challenges that they're looking at right now as their connection to Springfield Hospital.
The term peer run, I'm not familiar with. Can you flesh out what that is?
Yes, so it is essentially a peer run facility or program is one that is run by individuals who identify as having lived experience.
Okay.
And that, when you look nationally at other programs statewide, it's a very effective programming structure. It's a structure that many individuals who are seeking care seek out and request, and can work very well for some individuals.
How many of those do we have?
One. And that was a requirement of Act 79.
Is that a brick-and-mortar state-owned building?
No, this is owned by Pathways. I don't know if they own the building or actually rent the building, but it's a part of the Pathways program.
Okay. We help fund that program, but it's not the brick and mortar piece. It's not owned by the state.
It's not funded through the capital bill? Gotcha. Thank you.
And there is one other, the other peer run program, as the commission mentioned, the two-bed crisis bed program. That's right down in Rochester.
The VA Medical Center has 12 inpatient beds. Obviously, those are specifically designated for veterans. And the Brattleboro Retreat, of course, in addition to the 14 level one beds, has 75 beds. And then when we look at our child and youth capacity in terms of inpatient, we have 30 total beds statewide. All of that capacity is at the Brattleboro Retreat with 18 beds for adolescents, 12 beds for children. There is an additional program across the lake, CVPH, which is a child and adolescent inpatient unit that is connected to the UVM Health Network. We have been very hopeful that we would begin to be able to access some of that capacity, given the challenge that we have with youth and children waiting in EDs. We have been having some challenges in terms of having children and youth going across state lines and how our respective legal statutes do or don't agree with one another. So that is something that we're in the process of looking at and trying to better understand, because it would be wonderful, particularly for children and youth who might be in the northern part of the state of Vermont, not to have to travel all the way to the Brattleboro Retreat, but could simply access care just across the lake. But we have had some barriers to accessing that capacity.
Is this a facility that is part of One Care?
It's at Champlain Valley Physicians Hospital, which is a part of the UVM Health Network.
And it's located in what actual town is it?
It's
in Plattsburgh. Okay, so the next slide is designed just to give you a visual of the continuum of care from most intensive to community-based care. At the top, you'll see our level one inpatient facilities. The 45 beds are general inpatient hospital units, intensive recovery residences, our mental health crisis beds, group homes, transitional staffed housing. This would be programs like the MyPad program that has been an incredible model that the Howard Center actually started, which is actually pairing more independent apartment living with services and supports on site So it's kind of creating capacity for some independent living, as well as having some treatment and services on site. Good afternoon, Senator. How are you?
I was testifying in another.
Okay, well, just to fill you in on where we are doing a high-level overview of the analysis of residential bed needs that came out of the Rural Health Task Services requirement. We are not doing a deep dive into the full report, but just providing enough information to give the committee a sense of our capacity in terms of inpatient and residential beds. At the lowest level, or least restrictive and community-based, we're looking at shelter plus care vouchers, which is independent living that also has services attached. So that gives you kind of a sense, an overview of inpatient and residential capacity across the continuum of care and what that means in terms of intensity level. What number slide are we on for Senator Lyons?
No, it's not numbered.
Okay.
Got a map.
We're at the map.
We got a map thing.
Right. We know this committee likes maps. So we always make sure to throw in a couple of maps.
They staple on the right-hand side. Huh?
There you go.
There's a left-handed staple.
Opportunity for growth.
We were a little dyslexic in the memory.
Stretching.
Used to be a specialist.
We wanted to give you a visual sense of where residential capacity sits across the state. So this first slide, again, shows you where those group homes are, those intensive residentials. I do apologize, it's a little small to read. You can certainly see areas where we have not as much capacity as we would like. It's also important to remember that some of this capacity is statewide, like the intensive recovery residences, whereas group homes are much more community-based, but certainly something to think about as we go forward, because this begs the next question is, if we're going to invest in additional resources and capacity, where would our money be best spent? And what does that look like in terms of community and geography?
Do you have a companion map where your patient numbers are distributed? Like, for instance, if I was to say Essex County, are there any patients in Essex County? If so, how many?
We would have the number of residents in the programs.
Yeah, I guess it depends on, are you talking about numbers of, like, say, in Essex County, number of CRT individuals from Essex County, or individuals in a residence?
When I come to think of where should the brick and mortar be, knowing where the population is that's going to be utilizing these buildings is kind of helpful. I don't know if you've ever developed that kind of a map.
So what the in the rural health care bill, or the rural rural task force bill, I guess it's called, we asked for that information. We asked for what the needs were by county and location. So I don't know.
Yes, and we did an analysis of from your county of origin, where are you going in terms of accessing care. So we do have that data in here. That you might be asking for a slightly deeper dive on that data.
But we do have information of, you know, people who are, you know, for instance, you know, we have some 500 folks who are involuntarily hospitalized in a given year, roughly. We can tell you, you know, from which counties, how many from each county that those individuals come from, you know, things of that sort, which would give you some indication of the needs in the back of the local communities.
So in a more general direction, do you have numbers of people that you service, you know, throughout the year so that we can see?
Yes, we do have that information.
Well, there are.
And we are going to be looking at some occupancy numbers later in the report that will give you some of that as well. The next map essentially combines residential and inpatient beds. So you can see kind of geographically across the state where our residential capacity is and where our inpatient capacity is. And this is both children and adults. The next area I want to bring to the committee's attention is planned capacity increases. Vermont has made significant investments in expanding our capacity across the continuum of care. We do have the 12 new level one beds that are scheduled to come online at the Brattleboro Retreat sometime between June and August. Again, I talked a little bit about the occupancy rates of our current level one beds being at about 99% at any given time, thus justifying the significant need, knowing that's the highest acuity of individuals in the state of Vermont. Also, when we think about emergency department wait times, the length of stay for individuals who are on an involuntary status or under the care and custody of the Commissioner of Mental Health have the longer length of stay. It averages about 3.4 days versus involuntary individuals whose length of stay is about just under a day. So again, thus indicating where we're seeing the backups in the emergency departments, this level one capacity will be essential to alleviating that as we go forward. Longer term, the UVM Health Network, CVMC, is in the process of planning to construct 25 new inpatient beds. The Department of Mental Health has been working closely with them, again, in the spirit of our 10-year plan that we also presented today as we look at integration of mental health services within the broader healthcare system. It is excellent to see one of our larger healthcare providers come forward and commit to providing more additional inpatient capacity in the state of Vermont. They are looking at those 25 beds in terms of tiers. So tier one, tier two, and tier three, which would indicate acuity. At this point, we're in initial conversations, but have some sense that their tier one from a clinical acuity status would align with our level one acuity status. So what that will mean for us, as that new capacity comes online in our system of care, what will that mean for other areas of the system? Will we continue to need that additional capacity? Will there be areas to think about other different levels of care? But that certainly will give us more flexibility. One of the things I would also note about the 12 new level one beds at the Brattleboro Retreat, individuals at that time were actually thinking strategically about, as new capacity comes online, would we be able to repurpose those 12 new level one beds for maybe a different level of care. So they're being designed to be flexible, meaning that they could be potentially transitioned to maybe geriatric psychiatry, maybe more intensive residential if that's what we need at the time. But we are trying to be thoughtful about capacity overall, trying to ensure that we're maximizing our investments in these capital expenses, and certainly the 12 new level one beds represent a significant capital expense or investment on behalf of the state of Vermont. Of course, we also have our 16-bed physically secure recovery residence, which is also a significant capital investment on behalf of the state of Vermont and is essential in terms of the continuum of care, which we would consider more community-based care in terms of it being a therapeutic community residence. It is not inpatient acute hospital level of care, but serves as a step down. But again, we are moving in the right direction in terms of ensuring and scaling up essential capacity across the state system. So the next few slides get into more of the detail of the analysis, and I am happy to walk the committee through these slides. In the interest and time and other individuals who are here to present, we're also happy to come back and do a deeper dive, but I guess I would defer to the chair.
I think probably given the time, we're going to have another conversation about this as the plans come into fruition and we want to get updates on what the brick and mortar is doing. I just wanted to comment, though, that somebody in the farthest reaches of Essex County probably has to travel well over 100 miles for the nearest group home facility. That, I don't know if that's just the way things grew up, or we've decided there's just not enough need. Was there any rationale behind that?
I think the group homes are primarily run by the designated community mental health agencies. Some community mental health agencies have moved forward with building that capacity within their catchment area, if you will, and some have not. I don't know that that's necessarily reflective of needs. Certainly that's something that we look at in some of the analysis, is the rate of individuals who are utilizing group homes. One data point that is on the next slide that I'll bring to your attention is that Lamoille County, which would be Lamoille County Mental Health, has the highest percentage of individuals in group homes. They also have one of the largest group homes. So it's just interesting as you look at what's available in their community and how folks are utilizing it. And then the other side of that, when you look at the highest utilization of intensive recovery residences in Windham and Windsor County, that utilization is much higher than some other counties. And again, they have two intensive recovery residences in that area. So that's more analysis that we'll be doing. But yes, to your point, there are certainly areas where access to a local group home, you may not be able to access that in your community in certain regions. Certainly some individuals do move into group homes in other areas. They actually become a client of that respective designated mental health agency. One slide that I would bring your attention to, which is a few in, because I think it tells an important story about some of the capacity investments that are already underway, is this slide here. I don't know if, I apologize that they're not numbered. That's the one right there. This is involuntary patients, residential level of care needed upon discharge. That's at Southern Alliance. Yes. So what's important about this data point is that we surveyed all of our inpatient hospitals for 6 months, essentially asking them the question, because what we really want to understand is what is the unmet need in the state of Vermont in terms of discharge from inpatient. So we essentially asked them for individuals who were trying to move out of inpatient settings, what is the residential level of care needed at that time, whether it's accessible or not. And you can see here very clearly return to former independent housing. This clearly articulates that just housing in general remains a continued barrier to actually moving folks out of our inpatient settings. The intensive residential also rose to the surface in terms of a need area, and then the physically secure residential with EIP capacity. So that, again, just gives a sense of what is the unmet need. And then a further slide gets into some of the barriers to discharge. One of the other things I would note, that this data set also looks at occupancy rates in our group homes and our intensive recovery residences. Group home occupancy rates are just very close to 100% all the time, given the long stays. In our intensive residentials, we're actually seeing a slowdown in admissions, but an increase in length of stay, indicating that folks are likely getting a little bit stuck in those intensive recovery residences. So we just have to keep looking further down the system of care in order to really alleviate and manage flow as best as possible. And of course, to ensure that we're serving individuals in the least restrictive settings as possible. So I'll stop there.
Just one quick question.
Sure.
About your count for the number of people served.
Yes.
Yeah. Are those unique individuals, or are they not maybe the same person?
Which slide are you referring to?
I was referring to, I lost the page. Where were we on just before this? The number was 2,800, 2,815.
Yes, those are all the individuals that we currently serve in our CRT programs total. And then so out of those 2,800 individuals, then we did a breakdown of how many of those are being served in intensive recovery residences and in group homes, which indicates that a lot of the individuals in our CRT program are actually being served successfully in their community. It's a small percentage that are accessing these residential programs.
Okay.
Great question.
Okay, thank you both.
Yes. Do you want me to give a quick overview on suicide prevention in terms of what's in the governor's recommend, and then I'll let our other good partners talk about some of the great work that's happening?
I'm happy to hear that, because we're switching gears to that subject right now. So if you'd like to lead into that, that's wonderful.
Wonderful. So of course, Vermont continues to grapple with the impact of suicide in our state. It's something that we want to ensure more resources for. Suicide is the second leading cause of death in Vermont for ages 15 to 34. And certainly for our young people, this is reflected in the Vermont Youth Risk Behavior Survey. We're seeing higher rates of hopelessness, despair, depression. That number is even more alarming for LGBTQ youth. Vermont is poised to expand our suicide prevention efforts. We put forward some initiatives. Those have been supported by the administration and are reflected in the governor's recommended budget for FY21. We really tried to take a multi-pronged approach to how we were looking at suicide prevention across the state. Strategy number one is to expand our Vermont National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. When I first started my job as commissioner, I was getting a lot of phone calls from the National Lifeline because they were concerned that we had the lowest in-state call response in the nation. So at the time, that was a little bit embarrassing, given our focus on health and supporting our Vermonters. So this additional dollars to support the National Lifeline will be essential. Essentially, how other states utilize this, it's a national call number. I think they're actually moving towards getting federal approval for it to be a three-digit number, which will be wonderful. Those calls typically come into your state and are managed by maybe crisis centers, local crisis centers that are trained, that can then get that individual directly to the right resource at the right time. Vermont's in-state call rate was very, very low, and essentially our calls were getting bumped out of state, were actually being answered by folks in New Hampshire, which then, of course, you risk dropped calls, relying on an entity in another state to understand our system of care. So this funding will allow us to support three of our programs to get additional training and resources and capacity so we can increase our call rate from a 0% in-state response rate to a 70% in-state response rate by 2021. That will be partnering with Northwest Counseling and Support Services, Pathways Vermont, and 211. So very excited about this opportunity and support for individuals who are trying to seek care. Strategy two is expanding zero suicide in Vermont. There are many leaders in this room that will talk about zero suicide, and it's an incredible systemic framework for bringing more training and workforce development across the state. We've been able to pilot it in some regions with our designated community mental health agencies, but we have not been able to scale it up statewide in a way to really impact the socially, the optimal social impact that we want to see. So this will allow us to scale up zero suicide statewide, partnering with the Center for Health and Learning that will be supporting that implementation. I would also note that zero suicide also has a component of training that's related to support for veterans as well. That is another population that we're very concerned about, and I know the administration is concerned about. Strategy three gets to that, which is expanding programs and supports for older Vermonters and veterans. Suicide risk is often coupled with social isolation. We worry about particularly our elderly Vermonters who may be isolated or at higher risk. So one of our upstream suicide prevention strategies is to expand the Elder Care Clinician Program, which is run through the Department of Aging and Independent Living, to better support and have outreach to veterans so they can get the care that they need when they need it. So that's kind of the array of suicide prevention efforts that are being supported and are a part of the recommended budget for FY21.
Thank you for opening with my bill. I believe Senator Lyons is on that bill as well.
Yes. Thank you for your sponsorship.
You'll be here. Do you know how many mentally ill patients are incarcerated?
There is a high representation of individuals with mental health mental health challenges in our correctional system. I don't have the number off the top of my head.
I should say, with respect to that question, that in judiciary we are talking about that question. One of the concerns all along has been that somebody with real mental health needs should not be in jail. We all understand that. Traditionally, we have had a situation in this state where that was the place of last resort when there wasn't anything else available. But we've come to recognize that's not the way to go. So we're having that question resolved, but not inside of this committee. Just so you know, there's a lot of other committees and a lot of other conversations going on, but we are aware that that's a problem and we're trying to address it.
That was part of the Justice Oversight Committee work that we did over the summer and the fall. And so it's a jointly introduced bill from members of Health and Welfare and Judiciary that's being worked on in Judiciary. We'll maybe look at it a little bit in Health and Welfare. But it's an important, really a critically important issue.
When the other committees figure out who needs to be where, they tell us and we pick up that and figure out how to build it. That's exactly what it works.
That being said, this will take time, as everything does. So in the meantime, the monies that are being appropriated in this budget, will some of this be going to corrections, mental health services within corrections, or is that money set?
In terms of the suicide prevention?
So in terms of any of the new programs that you're...
So the capital dollars that are going to support the construction of new facilities is for the 12 new level one beds, as well as Middlesex.
But as far as the money that you're looking for suicide prevention, will any of that be going into corrections as well?
Not at this time.
Should be an appropriations question.
It's a big discussion.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay, was the lead in.
Yes,
and
thank you very much.
I understand there's a lot of other folks here that would like to give us some words on the next suicide prevention issues. I had Richard Fales.
Yes.
Good afternoon, Richard. I understand. Have you ever testified before a committee before?
Yes.
Okay. Please, go ahead.
I'm a CRT client, but also I'm a retired Lieutenant of Corrections. This morning I was an employee in my community. I started working at the Brain Training School where I worked until 1992. I began to work at Corrections for 16 years. Before working Corrections, I volunteered in the program, Flesh Holes and Decisions. This inmates program showed the best side. When I started in Woodstock, I went for a nurturing caring from Brain Training School that really helps the culture and life and our expected. The inmates were constantly on about to bring stuff into them and be willing to. The other day, you never knew what to expect. The more I started to be bothered with, the inmates were worse. You had to be consistent or they'd walk all over me. After about 6 months, it got easier to be consistent. The hardest part of the job was officers that did not abide by the rules and bring in contraband at times officers with great staff that did not conform themselves. Some brought in cartons of cigarettes for $100. Things got worse over time. We spent more time in the jail than with the family. We were constantly tired, especially if we worked 16 hours and had 45 minutes to drive home. And then we were expected to be back 8 hours later, which only gave about 4 hours of sleep. This is why we cannot retain staff. Many staff were medicating by using alcohol and drugs themselves to deal with stress. On my days off, I drank heavily and just wanted to sleep, especially when I worked for third shifts. It was hard on a young family, but by buying a new house and car to solve the problem, and there wouldn't be happiness. It did not work that way. We would go into debt and rely on overtime to survive, even working extra days. After working 5 years of corrections, I had my first suicide attempt, not only because of the job and family stress, which was one of the reasons why I divorced the divorce. Also, I was embarrassed by friends and family that I ended up in the slave ward where I spent a week. I thought that after a week I could return to work, and I did. It was even harder. The roof field and laughed at and bullied with some staff because I saw help. I said, well, after moving up the ranks correctional was shown more respect. However, the more responsibility, the more I drank, but the more years I threatened suicide and ended up in Bella's fault, which is a winning sign. Well, I was out of work for about 6 weeks and then I returned and was put on administrative duty. In 2003, I was transferred to Mar Valley where I was put on third shift. It was more difficult because there were more inmates and staff than I started used to. I had to get acclimated with more non intakes paperwork. We had screen intakes and initially surveyed to see where they would be held based on if they were suicidal. The amount of incapacity of people that came in were also difficult to deal with. With all the stress, I'd go home in the morning and drink until I could fall asleep. I switched from shift to shift over the next 4 years. My drinking and abuse my prescriptions, all in meds completely off, made the job harder. I was not taking care of myself. I didn't care what I looked like. My uniform were dirty and I was spiraling out of control and deep in debt. Family was my job and marriage. In 2007, I had a violent suicide. I was in the hospital for 5 months. It was the end of my career. For a 16-year period, there have been many officers like me who could not do the stress and had suicide attempts themselves. And most times, I've known 4 officers that have committed suicide. I look to speak to correctional sites and speak to officers about seeing the signs of suicide, not only in the inmates, but our staff that are overworked, stressed, having family problems, and by themselves. They need a place to feel safe and the taboo of getting help, staff is sensitive and empathetic, but also seek help and want to help others to not attempt suicide, because it hurts your family, friends, first responders, and community. I then heard about NOMI. I found our program in our own voices, which is celebrated darkest days and our personal success stories. Not only was I helping others, I was helping myself. I now spoke with the Department of Health, Team 2, and at the police academy. I tell everyone I can so someone else does not go through what I have gone through. I now have a job working as a peer support specialist part-time. There's a light in the tunnel to get help and help others with their experience of suicidality. Know the signs if someone you know is suicidal and depressed. Talk to them, they may tell you what's wrong. When you're suicidal, you don't care about anyone else. You just want to end the game. I never told my psychiatrist that I had guns in the house or I was drinking on it. I was frequently called on the suicide line, and now I call the Vermont State Support Line, which should be funded 24 hours a day to help people that are peers and compassion care.
Richard, appreciate you coming to share your story. Best of luck in the future.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I have Scott Ekus. Is it Ekus?
Yes, I know that we're on the topic of suicide now, and I would like to talk about residential beds.
Okay.
I just wonder, do you want to flip the suicide?
If it's okay with you and you have the time to hang around, I'd like to keep the subject the same if possible.
That's fine.
Thank you. Joellen Torello?
Yes, that's me.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm Joellen Torello. I'm the executive director of the Center for Health and Learning, and we are a 501c that is a state partner to many initiatives that address priority health issues. In most recent years, we did a lot of work early on in chronic disease prevention. In more recent years, we were the lead designated agency on behalf of Department of Mental Health to receive 2 suicide prevention grants. They were originally focused on youth, and when the grants, federal grants came to a screaming halt, we wondered what we were going to do. So we created the Vermont Suicide Prevention Center, which is a public-private partnership with the Agency of Human Services. And I have to say, I think it's a really good model. I'd like to see us, I just caught Commissioner Levine in the hall, I'd like to see us develop something similar around our substance misuse and opiate prevention kind of problems. And the reason I think it's a good model is because the coalition is composed of representatives cross-sector. Business, private, nonprofit, healthcare, education, social service, and also many people with lived experience. So they are able to inform state initiatives, and the state comes to the coalition to inform the coalition about directions and get input. We're able to move in parallel process. I think we've made some progressive progress on suicide prevention in Vermont in the last few years. And I think it's because we have a sort of a body moving in parallel process very closely with the state. So I did a little research on your committee to try and understand like how to gear this talk to your interests.
This is where I say, uh-oh.
One of the things we've been successful in doing in the last few years is working closely with the Agency of Human Services, and they've established a leadership team for suicide prevention. It's had, you know, some fits and starts, so to speak. Allison can speak to that better than I, as she is a representative and co-chair now of the leadership team for AHS. But I want to bring this up because you asked about corrections. And so the Department of Mental Health has been the lead agency on suicide prevention in Vermont by designating us as the original grantee, and then the money has flowed through Department of Mental Health, the zero suicide money also. But on this leadership team are representatives from all the departments in AHS. So, Department of Corrections, do they have a, they have a representative. Department of Children and Families, for example, they have a representative. And I think that is going to be our best opportunity to elevate the discussion about effective effective suicide practices in those departments. So, in other words, to get back to your question about corrections, We have a lot of momentum in Department of Mental Health, but suicide prevention can't just sit on the shoulders of mental health. We have a momentum now in Department of Vermont Healthcare Access with the blueprint and One Care getting on board with zero suicide. Again, this isn't just a healthcare issue, although healthcare certainly can shore up. Department of Corrections has a training for all of its workers, and it has traditionally delivered that training. And there are still, I think, there's still a desire to think more strategically about suicide prevention in corrections. And that's true for Department of Children and Families as well. They have yet to train their whole foster care system, for example, in suicide prevention awareness and training. So let's see. Suicide is complex, but here's what I can say that I think relates to your interests. An individual dies by suicide. And when they die by suicide, that has a huge, huge and traumatic impact, really for the rest of their lives on the family. The family lives in a community. The children, the youth, the young adults go to schools, colleges, institutions of higher ed. And the parents or family members work in workplaces. So we cannot underestimate or undervalue the return on investment in putting good suicide prevention practices in place. And anything we do for suicide prevention is going to build the overall system of care. So we have had the opportunity to work with the designated agencies who have shown a lot of commitment to zero suicide, and absolutely thrilled, really, use that word, and I don't use it lightly, that the governor has included a scale-up in their budget, and I'm hoping that will Center for Health and Learning and Vermont Suicide Prevention Center will be able to provide some backbone support. And backbone support is project management, it's training, it's resource development, but the work really goes on in the communities. And that's through our designated mental health system, some of our independent providers, and through our healthcare system. So individuals are suicidal and they enter a system somewhere. They enter it in the mental health agency, they enter it in the hospital, emergency room, they enter it in the primary care office, And all of those places have to be shored up in order to have the skills to assess, to screen and identify, determine if they're low, medium, high risk, and then to get them to the next point of care. And if there isn't a good warm handoff, so to speak, with protocols, that's when people get isolated, they feel alone, their hopelessness takes over, and they end up resorting in some crisis moment to a firearm, a poisoning, suffocation, whatever it is they choose to end their life. So if we want to deter that, then we have to shore up our people and shore up our connections in those systems and limit access to lethal means when a person is at high risk. So your institutions are composed of people, and it seemed to me as I was thinking about this, people need self-care, whether they're the people working in the systems who experience a lot of, you know, a lot of impact on the delivery of care to complex needs. And they are then at higher risk. So all of our correctional facilities, all of our healthcare workers, all of our, you know, and then the people in the systems, ideally, we can do as much as we can to create cultures of health. I just sat at the table, got a big hug from a survivor of suicide who has been part of our coalition. She said, "I started yoga." And I was like, "Yes, that's wonderful." Well, there are actually a lot of fairly low cost. I mean, yes, it's costly to train our staff and to ensure integrated staffing solutions, but, you know, fresh air, vitamin D, there's been large scale studies done on the role of vitamin D in institutions. It's actually considered an evidence-based practice. Yoga, mindfulness, meditation, things that teach us how to regulate, and this is how we can move it upstream, if we will, and also at the same time support the recovery of the people in the institutions. Prevention protocol is very important for institutions, that they all have protocols in place how to prevent a suicide, and sadly, we really need postvention protocol. Protocols for how to respond when there is an event because of all of the ripple effect. And we have exemplary policies and protocols, and templates that people can adapt to their institutions. We just need to continue to make progress on getting those introduced, adapted, adopted, and implemented. The last thing I would say is what we are learning about suicide is that there are subpopulations that are at highest risk or higher risk. So we know veterans are at higher risk because of all that they experience and because the culture does not encourage help seeking. Older men, middle-aged men, are actually at very high risk. Allison just shared some data. Most recent data is that the highest demographic in Vermont most recently is 25 to 55, so our middle-aged people. So GLBTQ, people dealing with GLBTQ, people experiencing domestic violence, you know, all the co-occurring factors. So each of those has its own risk factors and its own protective factors and its own cultural considerations for delivering service and creating a healthy environment. I'll stop there. Happy to take questions, and I will say that what we do is build out partnerships with agencies, organizations to bring capacity to address priority health issues, and if there's any way that we could support efforts in the future, that's why we exist. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Many questions. Thank you. Sure. I don't know if there's anybody else that wanted to speak on this particular subject. I guess, Scott, you're up to the plate.
Let's talk about residential. Thank you.
Thanks for coming and thanks for being patient.
Pardon?
Thanks for coming and thanks for being patient.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me. Really appreciate it. I'm Scott Akis. I'm the executive director of Collaborative Solutions Corporation. Sometimes people call the entire organization Second Spring, which is fine. We do run the Second Spring programs. How long do I get? A couple hours?
Well, it depends on whether you want to have a very upset committee.
It's a very small audience. Probably like 15 minutes, something like that.
Well, it would be, if you can weasel it into 12, because I have another group coming in at 2:45.
All right, let's try it. So I did provide the committee with some paperwork here that gives a summary for those who aren't familiar with our programs. We have 27 beds, so of the intensive residential program Sarah was talking about earlier, there are 47 of those. 27 of those are at Collaborative Solutions Corporation. It was originally founded to accept people out of the Vermont State Hospital who had severe and persistent mental illness labels like schizophrenia, severe bipolar disorder, schizoaffective disorder. And we still play an important role in that kind of flow. People come out of the designated hospitals, typically type 1 beds, into our care. We have a very close relationship with the DAs, but we're not a DA. I've broken it down by our different houses. We have a house in Williamstown that has 16 beds. We actually have another one in Williamstown with 3 beds and one in Westford with 8 beds. I want to highlight the level of clinical care. So the difference between us and a group home is that we offer really, we reach towards a hospital level of care of intensity. So we provide, there's the infamous map. Good, thank you. So we provide on-site psychiatry. We have a primary care advanced practice nurse who's responsible for the primary care needs of our population, which you may know has dies on average 10 to 25 years early due to primary care type issues. We have daily nursing care, 24/7 on call by both MD, RN, and a clinical specialist, case management, psychotherapy, vocational rehabilitation. Creative arts therapy is our most popular program. We used to have a music therapist, now we have a drama therapist. People love that. Substance use disorder treatment, peer support, and we coordinate with scores of off-site providers. The impact that we have on the system is something, this chart on slide 10 is similar to one of the slides that Sarah showed. Just, we're basically always full. Once in a while, we'll dip down a little bit, but for the most part, we're always full. A lot of the room in between us and 100% is because people may go to the hospital for a few days, or somebody may be discharged, and then we're waiting for somebody to take that bed. But basically, we're foolish. You can see that it's tremendously cost-effective when you look at slide 11. Those figures are a little bit outdated, but we're still south of $900 per bed day. And I believe VPCH has gone up to $2,700 per bed day. But I know these numbers are directly from VPCH, so in 2017 they were at 2466. You will notice that our cost per bed day has come down significantly. The reason for that is because our census is up. So it used to be that we didn't have as many bed days, so the divisor was a smaller number. Now we're full all the time, so that's why our costs per bed day have come down.
Can I ask the length of stay is?
So we're geared for about 9 months, but it really varies dramatically individual to individual, anywhere between 3 months and even like a couple of years. The reason that we've been able to be so successful, and this is really what I would like to end up building towards at the end of this talk, is that we were created at a time when the VSH, the Vermont State Hospital, needed to reduce its census, and people got people with lived experience, NAMI, Vermont psychiatric survivors, people who had knew what it was like to be in the hospital, as well as actual providers of the services, put them around the table and had them figure out what do we need to do to make a really great situation system. And they came up with Second Spring. Second Spring South was the first IRR with 14 beds. And it's just beautiful. I run into people across the state all the time who were part of birthing the organization. It's just beautiful, the heartfelt warmth that they have about that. I'll also tell you, I get calls from around the country for, from systems of care who want to replicate what Vermont is doing. So my hat, I was in Ohio at the time, my hat's off to the people in the state of Vermont who came up with this. Now, our mission is to create caring communities where people seeking mental health find hope, compassion, and excellent clinical care. I'm going to start by talking about that word compassion. Is everyone comfortable here?
Imagine this happens to be the worst room in the building for air quality.
House Human Services was, healthcare, I mean, was really tough. Imagine if you weren't comfortable and you were expected to stay in a place for 9 months. If you felt ostracized, people throughout the history of mankind with mental health issues have been ostracized and alienated and put over there or worse. Okay, and what we've done, what the state of Vermont has done, is created a situation where we're inclusive. We have a community that is compassionate towards people who have these diagnoses. All right, let's talk about hope for a second. At least several more minutes, so that's good. Let's talk about hope for a second. This is actually an important chart, this one here. It's number 16, and you can see that as people, before people enter, 54% of the people aren't even willing to vocalize that they want recovery. They don't even, they're not even willing to commit vocally, verbally to doing that. And 10% of the people, at discharge, 7% of the people aren't willing to verbalize that. Okay, in contrast, people who are still in the hospital waiting to come to us, 10% are actively involved in recovering, whereas at discharge, 42%. So you can see that people's commitment to a recovery way of life goes way up. And that's because they have hope when they come to us. So to get to the crux of this issue, I want to look at slide number 19. And this is something that I really would like to build on top of Sarah's presentation. If you look at that pie chart, look at 21% who leave us. 21% get discharged back to the hospital. That's not a bad number, considering where most folks came. Many of them came from spending a year in the hospital. So that's actually, we are fairly proud of that number. But those 21% are part of the flow, right? They are in beds in psychiatric hospitals that we're currently finding to be at a premium. So if we're looking at building a new IRR, not the one that Sarah's talking about, which is involuntary, but if we were to really talk about increasing our capacity, the system capacity, by building a new IRR, the number one thing that I would recommend is solving that blue triangle by talking to the people who are not feeling served, who's not feeling comfortable, who's feeling ostracized and alienated, even from our care. I tell you what, that's the worst feeling in the world. We get so many that we relate to them and they feel like they're cared about and they stay and they make it, and it makes a huge difference in their lives. When one gets away, we feel awful. So how do we reach those folks? Who's not getting reached?
well, just to look at the demographics, we have a dramatic increase in substance use disorder since we were born, from 25% to 85%. We have a dramatic increase in opioid use from 1% to 37% of our residents. Our residents are getting younger. That's slide 21. We have more clients with medical comorbidities that are life-threatening. That's slide 22. So when we sit down at the table, it's going to take more than just interviewing a few people at our residence, the people who are, by the way, willing to come down to the living room to talk, right? When we do surveys, we're talking about certain people who are willing to come down to the living room to talk. We need to talk to the people who are willing to come down to the living room to talk. And they're going to primarily be in certain demographics. Those with severe medical needs, this is slide 23, the LGBTQ community, dual diagnosis, substance use and mental health, significant forensic involvement, and those with a labeled diagnosis of personality disorder. So the takeaways are, the IRRs really work. They work from a financial perspective, and they work heart and soul. And doing right means funding those programs appropriately. More IRR beds is likely to lead to less ER onboarding and less hospitalization, but not just any IRR beds. What we're getting down to is the folks who aren't making it, even with the IRRs that we have. How do we actually reach in there and help them? So we have a whole minute left. We have a three-bed program that is a test case. It's called the Pierce House. Our first client was a gentleman who had spent almost his entire adult life in the psychiatric hospital, over 15 years, most of them in the psychiatric hospital. He's now been in our residence for 3 years with a total of 2 months hospitalized. That's magic. First of all, think how much it saved. But also, what does it mean to him? What does it mean to his mom? So we can do those things, but he wouldn't have done that in a larger program. So I really want to, you know, suggest that to the extent that the members of the committee are engaged in discussions about that, but we're really asking, you know, one size doesn't fit all, especially where we're at right now. And that's what I have for you today. Thank you for having me, and I'd love to answer any questions.
So, good, and we'll probably have you come in to our Health and Welfare Committee at some point. But I have a lot of questions about the funding, how it got started, what funding was utilized, and what keeps you going, and, you know, what's the patient source of funding, how much is Medicaid, how much is other stuff. So I think that's a big area for our consideration.
I'll be happy to
join
the committee or answer questions in by email or however you like.
We'll sort it out.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I mean, this committee might be interested in that, too.
So, and you're not a designated agency. So,
no.
How do you get your clients, your residents?
They're referred ultimately by the DAs through the Department of Mental, with the Department of Mental Health's collaboration. So it's a statewide referral pool to us.
And is there, like, requirements? Like, if you only have a few beds, and who does the determining of who gets to get to?
There's, yeah, that's a great question. It's a fairly intricate thing. We have a full-time position responsible for the ongoing dialogue with the psychiatric hospitals and the DAs about who the next person that's likely to be successful is and when is our next bed going to open up. And then that person also collaborates with our clinical director and director of nursing, as well as, if necessary, psychiatrists, to make sure it's an appropriate referral.
We need a good bed board.
And we use the bed board. Wow. You've got knowledge here.
Scott, I appreciate your testimony. Again, dances along the periphery of where this committee is involved. Ginny's committee, Health and Welfare, is probably going to get involved.
You make all the decisions.
She makes all the decisions. You guys, we make all the decisions?
Oh, yeah. We come to this, yeah.
But we appreciate you giving us the picture from Second Spring.
Thank you all.
Thank you. It's great.
Thank you for coming. Committee, we're going to take a 12-13 minute recess.